Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Golden Gulag, Prisons, Surplus, Crisis, and Opposition in Globalizing California, by Ruth Wilson Gilmore, narrated by Machelle Williams. Publisher's note: this audiobook includes bonus material. Please visit tantor.com and type Golden Gulag into the search box. Follow the link to the book's page, then, under the supplemental content section, please enter the access code GROWTH, and then click the unlock button to access the bonus material. The code should be entered in all lowercase letters. All figures and tables referenced in this audiobook can be found in the bonus material. Prologue: The Bus. One midnight in the middle of April, late in the 20th century, a bus pulled out of the Holman Methodist Church parking lot. Traveling a short way along the northern boundary of south-central Los Angeles, it geared up a ramp into the web of state and federal highways that connect California's diverse industrial, agricultural, and recreational landscapes into the fifth-largest economy in the world. On the bus, 40 women, men, and children settled in for the seven-hour journey north to Sacramento and the state capital. A dream crowd rode for freedom. Red, black, brown, yellow, and white. Mothers, fathers, grandparents, sisters, brothers, children, lovers, and friends. Gay men and lesbians. Interracial families. English, Spanish, Tagalog, Arabic, Polish, and Hebrew speakers. Catholic, Protestant, Jew, Muslim, Eastern Orthodox, and Quaker. Their diversity embodied some 150 years of California history and more than 300 years of national anxieties and antagonisms. But the riders didn't worry about it. They got on the bus because of their sameness: employed, disabled, or retired working people with little or no discretionary income, whose goal was freedom for their relatives serving long sentences behind bars. The dream riders were summoned by a nightmare, made palpable by the terrifying numbers of prisoners and prisons produced during the past generation, while we were all, presumably, awake. Just as real was the growing grassroots activism against the expanded use of criminalization and cages as catch-all solutions to social problems. In order to realize their dream of justice in individual cases, the riders decided, through struggle, debate, failure, and renewal, that they must seek general freedom for all from a system in which punishment has become as industrialized as making cars, clothes, or missiles, or growing cotton. Against the odds, they had come to activism, acting out in the details of modest practices, the belief that we shall overcome the deep divisions so taken for granted in apartheid America. In other words, they shared more than an interest. Purpose made them ride. Some snoozed, some played cards, some talked about who would join them on the statehouse steps, who would sit with them in the Senate Committee on Public Safety hearing room, and what best strategy would persuade a prisoner-hostile legislative committee majority to amend California's three strikes and you're out law. Some watched through the window with an intensity suggesting that the night might reveal an answer. Instead, what they saw were landscapes of labor, living, and leisure stretching out beyond the horizon. Leaving Los Angeles, the bus traveled up the broad old industrial corridor's central artery. Although the city is still the manufacturing capital of the United States, the mix and remuneration of jobs making things has changed drastically in the past 20 years. Auto and primary steel are mostly gone, replaced by apparel and rebar. On Interstate 5, the great road over the Tehachapi Mountains, the bus passed endless residential developments and signs touting business-friendly regions in the northern reaches of Los Angeles County before slipping into the darkness of the Angeles National Forest. The federal interstates enabled suburbanization of both residents and industry and helped secure California's historical dominance in the military-industrial complex. Indeed, for most of the families on the bus, overt wars, World War II, Korean, and Vietnam, and covert struggles, Jim Crow Mississippi and Louisiana, were the forces that had pushed and pulled them to Southern California to remake their lives as long-distance migrants must. Rolling down the long grade into the Great Central Valley, some of the writers speculated about the gargantuan pumping stations that propel water gathered from the state's northern and eastern regions over the mountains to quench the Southland's thirst. And yet, although the water courses up out of the valley, a lot remains to irrigate the state's agricultural immensity. Indeed, while agriculture is only 3% of gross state product, GSP, California ranks first in the United States in agricultural production. They stopped in Bakersfield to pick up more people, a farm worker, an unemployed journalist, some prisoners' mothers taking an unpaid day off work and contributing from their slim wages toward the $1,000 charter cost. Outside Bakersfield, darkness grew in again around the Thomas-built coach. A small group of riders sitting in the back started to count sightings of intensely golden glows that eerily poked depth into the flat blackness. These concentrations of light in farmland are many of California's new prisons, cities of men, and sometimes women, that lie next to the dim towns that host them. Some passengers whispered their words recorded as breath on glass. "Donnie's over there. Hello, Richard. I wonder if Angel's sleeping. I told him we'd pass by." The small fogs cleared as the bus labored on. Other buses make this journey every day from central Los Angeles, leaving not from churches, but rather from courts and jails. Their destinations are the old or new prisons, those that cluster along Highway 99 and make it a prison alley, and others further afield, from the sturdy perimeter of fortresses along the California-Mexico border in the south up to Indian country at Susanville and Crescent City at the Oregon line. 900 miles of prisons, an archipelago of concrete and steel cages, 33 major prisons, plus 57 smaller prisons and camps, 43 of the total built since 1984. Arriving in Sacramento, the riders join their allies from other parts of the state for a prayer breakfast and a rally on the Capitol steps. Then the day's principal activity began, the long committee session. They would try again to persuade people eager for re-election, who review and approve new criminal laws 3 hours a week, every week, to undo part of one law even while a major campaign contributor, the Prison Guards Union, summoned its lobbyist brigades to denounce any reform. For a moment before the group moved indoors, the ordinarily gray-white state buildings yellowed to reflect the warming sunrise, a sensation welcomed by a few aching elderly passengers, always alert for signs of hope. Perhaps on this trip, they might knock one block out of the Golden Gulag's miles and miles of prison walls. 1. Introduction. The Problem. This book is about the phenomenal growth of California's state prison system since 1982, and grassroots opposition to the expanding use of prisons as catch-all solutions to social problems. It asks how, why, where, and to what effect one of the planet's richest and most diverse political economies has organized and executed a prison-building and filling plan that government analysts have called the biggest in the history of the world. By providing answers to these questions, the book also charts changes in state structure, local and regional economies, and social identities. Golden Gulag is a tale of fractured collectivities, economies, governments, cities, communities, and households, and their fitful attempts to reconstruct themselves. The book began as two modest research projects undertaken in Los Angeles in 1992 and 1994 on behalf of a group of mostly African-American mothers, many of whom later rode the bus depicted in the prologue. All wished to understand both the letter and intent of two California laws, the Street Terrorism Enforcement and Prevention STEP Act 1988 and Proposition 184, the Three Strikes and You're Out Law, 1994. They asked me, a non-lawyer activist with research skills, access to university libraries, and a big vocabulary, to help them. The oral reports and written summaries I presented at Saturday workshops failed to produce what we hoped for: clues as to how individual defendants might achieve better outcomes in their cases. Rather, what we learned, twice over, was this. The laws had written into the penal code breathtakingly cruel twists in the meaning and practice of justice. Why should such discoveries surprise people for whom racism and economic struggle are persistent, life-shortening aspects of everyday experience? Perhaps because, for an increasing number of people, by the early 1990s, everyday experience had come to include familiarity with the routines of police, arrests, lawyers, plea bargains, and trials. The repertoire of the criminal courts seemed to be consistent, if consistently unfair, with everyone playing rather predictable roles and the devil, or acquittal, in the details. But instead of showing how to become more detail-savvy about a couple of laws, our group study shifted our perspective by forcing us to ask general, and therefore to our general frustration, more abstract questions. Why prisons? Why now? Why for so many people, especially people of color? And why were they located so far from prisoners' homes? The complex inquiry we inadvertently set for ourselves eventually defined the scope of this book, whose tale unfolds four times: statewide, at the Capitol, in rural Corcoran, and in South Central Los Angeles. Working through California's prison development from these various cuts, we'll uncover the dynamics of the social and spatial intersections where expansion emerged. There's a political reason for doing things this way. It is not only a good theory in theory, but also a good theory in practice for people engaged in the spectrum of social justice struggles to figure out unexpected sites where their agendas align with those of others. We can do this by seeing how general changes connect with concrete experiences, as the mothers did in our study groups. The California state prisoner population grew nearly 500% between 1982 and 2000, even though the crime rate peaked in 1980 and declined, unevenly but decisively, thereafter. African Americans and Latinos comprised two-thirds of the state's 160,000 prisoners. Almost 7% are women of all races. 25% are non-citizens. Most prisoners come from the state's urban cores, particularly Los Angeles and the surrounding southern counties. More than half the prisoners had steady employment before arrest, while upwards of 80% were, at some time in their case, represented by state-appointed lawyers for the indigent. In short, as a class, convicts are de-industrialized cities, working or workless poor. Since 1984, California has completed 23 major new prisons at a cost of $280 to $350 million apiece. The state had previously built only 12 prisons between 1852 and 1964. The gargantuan new poured concrete structures loom at the edge of small, economically struggling, ethnically diverse towns in rural areas. California has also added, in similar locations, 13 small, 500-bed, community corrections facilities, 5 prison camps, and 5 mother prisoner centers to its pre-1984 inventory. By 2005, a hotly contested 24th new prison, designed to cage 5,160 men, will, if opened, bring the total number of state lockups for adult men and women to 90. With the exception of a few privately managed 500-bed facilities, these prisons are wholly public, owned by the state of California, financed by Public Works Board debt, and operated by the California Department of Corrections. The state's general fund provides 100% of the entire prison system's annual costs. Expenses spiked from 2% of the general fund in 1982 to nearly 8% today. The Department of Corrections has become the largest state agency, employing a heterogeneous workforce of 54,000. These alarming facts raise many urgent issues involving money, income, jobs, race and ethnicity, gender, lawmaking, state agencies, and the policies that propel them to act, rural communities, urban neighborhoods, uneven development, migration and globalization, hope and despair. Such breadth belies the common view that prisons sit on the edge, at the margins of social spaces, economic regions, political territories, and fights for rights. This apparent marginality is a trick of perspective, because as every geographer knows, edges are also interfaces. For example, even while borders highlight the distinction between places, they also connect places into relationships with each other and with non-contiguous places. So too with prisons. The government-organized and funded dispersal of marginalized people from urban to rural locations suggests both that problems stretch across space in a connected way and that arenas for activism are less segregated than they seem. Viewed in this way, we can see how prison is actually in the middle of the muddle that confronts all modestly educated working people and their extended communities, the global supermajority, at the dawn of the 21st century. What is prison supposed to do, and why? The practice of putting people in cages for part or all of their lives is a central feature in the development of secular states, participatory democracy, individual rights, and contemporary notions of freedom. These institutions of modernity, shaped by the rapid growth of cities and industrial production, faced a challenge, most acutely, where capitalism flourished unfettered to produce stability from the accumulation and useful administration of people on the move in a society of strangers. Prisons both depersonalized social control so that it could be bureaucratically managed across time and space, and satisfied the demands of reformers who largely prevailed against bodily punishment, which nevertheless endures in the death penalty and many torturous conditions of confinement. Oddly enough, then, the rise of prisons is coupled with two major upheavals: the rise of the word freedom to stand in for what's desirable, and the rise of civil activists to stand up for who's dispossessed. The relationship of prison to dispossession has been well studied. Wedged between ethics and the law, the justification for putting people behind bars rests on the premise that as a consequence of certain actions, some people should lose all freedom, which we can define in this instance as control over one's bodily habits, pastimes, relationships, and mobility. It takes muscular political capacity to realize wide-scale dispossession of people who have formal rights, and historically those who fill prisons have collectively lacked political clout commensurate with the theoretical power that rights suggest. In contrast, during most of the modern history of prisons, those officially devoid of rights, indigenous and enslaved women and men, for example, or new immigrants, or married white women, rarely saw the inside of a cage because their unfreedom was guaranteed by other means. But what about crime? Doesn't prison exist because there are criminals? Yes and no. While common sense suggests a natural connection between crime and prison, what counts as crime in fact changes, and what happens to people convicted of crimes does not, in all times and places, result in prison sentences. Defined in the simple terms of the secular state, crime means a violation of the law. Laws change depending on what, in a social order, counts as stability, and who, in a social order, needs to be controlled. Let's look at a range of examples. After the Civil War, an onslaught of legal maneuvers designed to guarantee the cheap availability of Southern Black people's labor outlawed both moving around and standing still. And convicts worked without choice or compensation to build the region's infrastructure and industrial system. From the 1890s onward, a rush of Jim Crow laws both fed on earlier labor-focused statutes and sparked the nationwide apartheid craze. The 18th Amendment to the Constitution, 1919, prohibited the manufacture, import, export, or sale of intoxicating liquors at a time when most drugs that are now illegal were not. In Texas, driving while drinking alcohol is legal, whereas a marijuana seed can put a person in prison for life. Prostitution is legal in some places. In others, the remedy for theft is restitution, not a cage. Murder is the result of opportunity, motive, and means, and the fact of a killing begins rather than ends an inquiry into the shifting legal nature of such a loss. Numerous histories and criminological treatises show shifts over time in what crime is and why it matters. Contemporary comparative studies demonstrate how societies that are relatively similar, industrialized, diverse, largely immigrant, differ widely in their assessments and experience of disorderly behavior and the remedies for what's generally accepted as wrong. As we can see that crime is not fixed, it follows that crime's relationship to prisons is the outcome of social theory and practice, rather than the only possible source of stability through control. How are prisons supposed to produce stability through controlling what counts as crime? Four theories condense 2.25 centuries of experience into conflicting and generally overlapping explanations for why societies decide they should lock people out by locking them in. Each theory, which has its intellectuals, practitioners, and critics, turns on one of four key concepts: retribution, deterrence, rehabilitation, or incapacitation. Let's take them in turn. The shock of retribution, loss of liberty, supposedly keeps convicted persons from doing again upon release what sent them to prison. Retribution's specter, deterrence, allegedly dissuades people who can project themselves into a convicted person's jumpsuit from doing what might result in lost liberty. Rehabilitation proposes that the unfreedom of prisons provides an occasion for the acquisition of sobriety and skills so that, on release, formerly incarcerated people can live lives away from the criminal dragnet. And, finally, incapacitation, the least ambitious of all these theories, simply calculates that those locked up cannot make trouble outside of prison. These theories relate to each other as reforms, not as steps away from brutality or inconsistency, but as attempts to make prisons produce social stability through applying some mix of care, indifference, compulsory training, and cruelty to people in cages. If the fourth concept, incapacitation, is not ambitious in a behavioral or psychological sense, it is, ironically, the theory that undergirds the most ambitious prison-building project in the history of the world. Incapacitation doesn't pretend to change anything about people except where they are. It is, in a simple-minded way, then, a geographical solution that purports to solve social problems by extensively and repeatedly removing people from disordered, deindustrialized milieus and depositing them somewhere else. But does the absence of freedom for many ensure stability in the form of lower crime communities and idled courts and police officers for others? We can hazard a quick guess by asking a different question. Would the prevailing theories shift and mingle over time, persistently reforming reformed reforms, if the outcome were stability? Probably not. And now there's more to be said on the subject, since we can count and compare outcomes. State by state, those jurisdictions that have not built a lot of prisons and thrown more people into them have enjoyed greater decreases in crime than states where incapacitation became a central governmental activity. For the latter, there are similar patterns of contrariness. Within California, counties that aggressively use mandatory sentencing, such as the notoriously harsh three strikes law, have experienced feebler decreases in crime than counties that use the law sparingly. Here, we must briefly digress and reflect further on prison demographics, in particular, their exclusive domination of working or workless poor, most of whom are not white. Since it has never before been so easy for people of color to get into prison, jail is another matter. We have to ask how racism works to lock in both them and more poor white people as well. To what degree has the regular observer of any race learned both willfully and unconsciously to conclude that the actual people who go to prison are the same as those the abolitionist Ruth Morris called the terrible few? The terrible few are a statistically insignificant and socially unpredictable handful of the planet's humans whose psychopathic actions are the stuff of folktales, tabloids, including the evening news and reality television, and emergency legislation. When it comes to crimes and prisons, the few whose difference might horribly erupt stand in for the many whose difference is emblazoned on surfaces of skin, documents, and maps, color, credo, citizenship, communities, convictions. The paroxysmal thinking required to make such a substitution is the outcome of many prods and barbs in which aggression, violence, order, and duty conflate into an alleged force of American human nature. This thinking reveals the imaginary relationships people have with neighbors, recast as strangers in a thoroughly racialized and income-stratified political economy that regularly redefines possibilities while never setting absolute positive or negative limits. With the vexing question of difference in mind, let's return to the problem of spatial unevenness. If places that spare the cage are calmer than places that use imprisonment more aggressively, why is this so? Why wouldn't higher rates of incapacitation produce more stability? As it turns out, if we ratchet our perspective down to an extremely intimate view and compare, we see that identical locations, in terms of the social, cultural, and economic characteristics of inhabitants, diverge over time into different qualities of place when one of them experiences high rates of imprisonment of residents. And, more, the tipping point, when things start to get really bad, is not very deep. Only two or three need to be removed from in to produce greater instability in a community of people who, when employed, make, move, or care for things. Why? For one thing, households stretch from neighborhood to visiting room to courtroom, with a consequent thinning of financial and emotional resources. Looking around the block at all the homes, research shows that increased use of policing and state intervention in everyday problems hasten the demise of the informal, customary relationships that social calm depends on. People stop looking out for each other and stop talking about anything that matters in terms of neighborly well-being. Cages induce or worsen mental illness in prisoners, most of whom eventually come out to service-starved streets. Laws such as lifetime bans from financial aid and fiscal constraints, displacing dollars from social investment to social expense, lock former prisoners out of education, employment, housing, and many other stabilizing institutions of everyday life. In such inhospitable places, everybody isolates. And when something disruptive, confusing, or undesirable happens, people dial 911. As a result, crime goes up, along with unhappiness, and those who are able to do so move away in search of a better environment, concentrating unhappiness in their wake. In other words, Prisons wear out places by wearing out people, irrespective of whether they have done time. This book asks how prison came to be such a wide-scale solution in late 20th century California, in part by looking at the problem through two extraordinary lenses. It asks what the relationship is between urban and rural political and economic restructuring, and how urban social expense fits into the rural landscape. It also asks what happens in the urban neighborhoods prisoners come from when people start talking to each other again. The dominant and counter-explanations for prison growth. In its briefest form, the dominant explanation for prison growth goes like this. Crime went up, we cracked down, crime came down. Is this true? The media, government officials, and policy advisors endlessly refer to the public's concern over crime and connect prison growth to public desire for social order. In this explanation, what is pivotal is not the state's definition of crime per se, but rather society's condemnation of rampant deviant behavior, thus a moral, not necessarily legal, panic. The catapulting of crime to public anxiety number one, even when unemployment and inflation might have garnered greater worry in the recessions of the early 1980s and the early 1990s, suggests that concerns about social deviance overshadowed other, possibly more immediate issues. However, by the time the great prison roundups began, crime had started to go down. Mainstream media widely reported the results of statistics annually gathered and published by the FBI, the Bureau of Justice Statistics, BJS, and state attorneys general. In other words, if the public had indeed demanded crime reduction, the public was already getting what it wanted. California officials could have taken credit for decreasing crime rates without producing more than 140,000 new prison beds, more than a million nationally. Another explanation for the burgeoning prison population is the drug epidemic and the presumed threat to public safety posed by the unrestrained use and trade of illegal substances. Information about the controlling, or most serious, offense of prisoners seems to support the drug explanation. Drug commitments to federal and state prison systems surged 975% between 1982 and 1999. Therefore, it is reasonable to conclude that the widening use of drugs in the late 1970s and early 1980s provoked prison expansion. According to this scenario, as news stories, sensational television programs, popular music and movies, and politicians' anecdotes made abundantly clear, communities, especially poor communities of color, would be more deeply decimated by addiction, drug dealing, and gang violence were it not for the restraining force of prisons. The explanation rests on two assumptions. First, that drug use exploded in the 1980s, and second, that the sometimes violent organization of city neighborhoods into gang enclaves was accomplished in order to secure drug markets. In fact, according to the BJS, illegal drug use among all kinds of people throughout the United States declined drastically starting in the mid-1970s. Second, although large-scale traffic in legal or illegal goods requires highly organized distribution systems, whether corporations or gangs, not all gangs are in drug trafficking. For example, according to Mike Davis, in the late 1980s, Los Angeles, despite the availability of stiffer sentences for gang members, prosecutors charged only 1 in 4 dealers with gang membership, and that pattern continued through the 1990s, despite media reports to the contrary. A third explanation blames structural changes in employment opportunities. These changes have left large numbers of people challenged to find new income sources, and many have turned to what one pundit called illegal entitlements. In this view, those who commit property crimes, along with those who trade in illegal substances, reasonably account for a substantial portion of the vast increase in prison populations. controlling offense data for new prisoners support the income supplementing explanation. The percentage of people in prison for property offenses has more than doubled since 1982. But at the same time, incidents of property crime peaked in 1980. Indeed, the drop in property crime pushed down the overall crime rate. Throughout the economic boom of the 1990s, both print and electronic media again headlined annual federal reports about long-term drops in crime, falling since 1980, and elected and appointed officials took credit for the trends. In this context, the explanation for bulging prison centers on the remarkable array of stiffer mandatory sentences now doled out for a wide range of behavior that used to be differently punished, if at all. This explanation, tied to but different from the moral panic explanation, proposes that while social deviance might not have exploded after all, aggressive intolerance pays handsome political dividends. The explanation that new kinds of sentences, which is to say the concerted action of lawmakers, rather than crisis in the streets, produced the growth in prison is after the fact and begs the question, why prisons now? Indeed, the preceding series of explanations and their underlying weaknesses suggest that the simple relationship between crime and crackdown, introducing this section, should be tweaked in the interest of historical accuracy. The string of declarative statements more properly reads, crime went up, crime came down, we cracked down. If the order is different, then so are the causes. Here, of course, is where the prevailing alternative explanations come in. These views, like the official stories, are not mutually exclusive. A key set of arguments charges racial cleansing. Prisons grow in order to get rid of people of color, especially young black men, accomplishing the goal through new lawmaking, patterns of policing, and selective prosecution. These analysts prove their claims using two decades of numbers showing the racial disparities in flesh-and-blood facts of prison expansion, substantial for white people and off the charts for nearly everybody else. There's no doubt what the accumulated experience is. But why now? Among many who charge racism, folk wisdom, a product of mixing the 13th Amendment with thin evidence, is that prison constitutes the new slavery, and that the millions in cages are there to provide cheap labor for corporations looking to lower stateside production costs. The problem with the new slavery argument is that very few prisoners work for anybody while they're locked up. Recall the generally accepted goal for prisons has been incapacitation, a do-nothing theory if ever there was one. There has certainly been enough time for public and private entities to have worked out the logistics of exploiting unfree labor, and virtually every state, including California, has a law requiring prisoners to work. But the fact that most prisoners are idle and that those who work do so for a public agency undermines the view that today's prison expansion is the story of 19th century Alabama writ large. The principal reason private interests fail to exploit prisoner labor seems to be this. Big firms can afford to set up satellite work areas, what a prison-based production facility would be, while small firms cannot. Small firms then fight against big firms over unfair access to cheap labor, and fight as well against publicly owned and operated prison industries, such as the federal system called Unicor. That, due to low wages, not the same as low labor costs, unfairly compete in markets selling things modestly educated people can make and do. Two other counter-explanations focus on the pursuit of profits. The first places emphasis on the privatization of public functions. Although the absolute number of private prisons has indeed grown, the fact is that 95% of all prisons and jails are publicly owned and operated. So the argument that more people are in prison due to the lobbying efforts of private prison firms doesn't stand up to scrutiny. The firms are not insignificant, especially in some jurisdictions, but they're not the driving force either. Despite boosterish claims by stock analysts, private prison firms consistently hover on the brink of disaster, while public sector unions fight against losing jobs with good pay and benefits. The final profit-centered explanation focuses more generally on the potential for pulling surplus cash out of prisons. The question remains as to how these changes came into effect, given the welter of laws and rules directing the uses of capital for public investments. In other words, what does the fact that the world has gone capitalist in the past decade and a half mean, and what are the conditions under which other possibilities might unfold? In particular, how has the role of the state at various levels, from urban growth machine to federal devolution machine, changed in the attempt to produce stability and growth in the general political economy, especially if equity is no longer on the agenda? The preceding discussion leads us to the third view, which holds that there are more people in prison in order for the state to help rural areas hungry for jobs. In this explanation of prison expansion, prisoners of color presumably provide employment opportunities for white guards. There's no question that rural America has been in the throes of a depression that began decades ago. In the 1980s and early 1990s, a welter of scholarly and trade articles promoted the local development discourse and advised prison agencies and civic boosters how to dispel fears and thereby disarm the NIMBY, not in my backyard, attitude. Such work reinforced the suspicion that prison expansion is a concrete manifestation of urban-rural competition and conflict. However, we now know the fiscal benefits to prison towns are difficult, if impossible, to locate. But where are the new prisons? Are the host communities and the places prisoners come from so different? What about the demographic continuities between employees and the prisoners themselves? Indeed, what already existing relationships make a town eligible for, or vulnerable to, prison siting in the first place? And why doesn't investment stick there? A fourth counter-explanation is one we might call the reform school. Analysts from a variety of political perspectives examine more than two centuries of interlocking prison and legal reforms and ask what role activists of many kinds, such as benevolent liberals or women fighting domestic and sexual violence, play, first in normalizing prison and then enabling its perpetually expanding use as an all-purpose remedy for the thwarted rights of both prisoners and harmed free persons. This view demands consideration of how political identities defined by injury and order derived from punishment shape state norms and practices. Through formal interaction with the state, as girl, student, citizen, immigrant, retiree, worker, owner, so forth, people develop and modulate their expectations about what the state should do, and these understandings, promoted or abhorred by media, intellectuals, and others, guide how and under what conditions social fixes come into being. The state makes things, but it is also a product of what's made and destroyed, of the constant creation and destruction of things such as schools, hospitals, art museums, nuclear weapons, and prisons. These issues return us to the question of why the state changes. How do we understand such change through the development or revision of governmental institutions? Before concluding this introduction to the problem, let's look quickly at a key historical moment of the 20th century, 1968. Looking backward to look forward. The preceding brief review of counter-explanations for prison growth does not account for the order of things. Crime went up, crime came down, we cracked down. But of course, as every explanation suggests, something big, which proponents of crime is the problem, prison is the solution, could be part of, directed the action. A conspiracy? Not likely. Systemic? Without a doubt. All the elements are here. Let's look back for a moment to 1968, symbolically the year of revolution and counter-revolution, to get one more take on the picture. 1968 was a disorderly year, when revolutionaries around the world made as much trouble as possible in as many places as possible. Overlapping communities of resistance self-consciously connected their struggles. Growing opposition to the U.S. war in Vietnam and Southeast Asia linked up with anti-colonialism and anti-apartheid forces on a world scale, and many found in Black Power a compelling invigoration of historical linkages between First and Third World liberation, not unlike the way people today, trying to make sense of anti-globalization, look to the Zapatistas in Chiapas. Students and workers built and defended barricades from Mexico City to Paris, sat down in factories, and walked out of fields. The more militant anti-capitalism and international solidarity became everyday features of U.S. anti-racist activism. The more vehemently the state responded by, as Alan Feldman puts it, individualizing disorder into singular instances of criminality. The years 1967 through 1968 also marked the end of a long run-up in annual increases in profit, signaling the close of the golden age of U.S. capitalism. The golden age had started 30 years earlier, when Washington began the massive buildup for World War II. The organizational structures and fiscal authority that had been designed for New Deal social welfare agencies provided the template for the Pentagon's painstaking transformation. It changed from a periodically expanded and contracted Department of War to the largest and most costly bureaucracy of the federal government. The United States has since committed enormous resources to the first permanent warfare apparatus in the country's pugnacious history. The wealth produced from warfare spending did two things. It helped knit the nation's vast marginal hinterland, the South and the West, into the national economy by moving vast quantities of publicly funded construction and development projects and people to do the work to those regions, with California gaining the most. The wealth also underwrote the motley welfare agencies that took form during the Great Depression, but did not become truly operational until the end of World War II. Indeed, the U.S. welfare state has been dubbed military Keynesianism, an unpronounced.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.